So the last talk for this afternoon is by Tomasz Zieliński, and he's going to tell us a few things about the security of Android banking apps in Poland. So Tomasz, the floor is yours.
Hello, my name is Tomasz Zieliński. Today morning we heard an excellent speech of Nikolai, who explained how to check the security of Android application, and I'd like to tell you about the possible results when you look at banking applications. Topic of my speech is state of security of Android banking app in Poland. A few words about me. If the remote works. Okay. So I've been a software developer for like 15 years now. I started in database area, then switched to embedded devices, then joined Microsoft to work on Bing search engine. I also had the opportunity to work on one of the features of Angry Birds Classic. I'm currently a software team, Android team leader in PGS Software, which is a Polish software house. Small ad, we employ about 500 people. We do all kinds of software, maybe except games. So if you need some software, just let me know. As my daily job, I work for over a year and a half developing mobile banking application for Android for one of our Western European customers. We tried to do our best following all the good practices. And I was wondering whether other developers of other banking applications are also doing good job. So I installed a few of banking applications. And in basically half an hour, I collected a bunch of security issues, minor and major. And I went to my boss and told him that it may be an interesting topic of research and development project of ours. He agreed. I got some budget, and I started investigating. The whole project was intended as white hat research, which pretty worked out because, as we know, the banks are pretty sensitive about their brands, and there were no lawsuits at the end, no jail time, so full success. This wasn't an official pen testing, which means I acted as a regular customer. I opened bank accounts in 18 Polish banks. Opening is much easier than closing, but it's another story. I opened those accounts, installed applications, and began to check what is the level of services I was provided. Just a note, this won't be a ranking. I only had a few hours with each application, so it's possible that I missed some of vulnerabilities, maybe even more critical that I will describe. So please don't treat it as a ranking that this application is better, this application is worse. It will be just a series of examples what can be found when you look closely. Also, just a note, all vulnerabilities and security issues I found was reported to banks at least a month before public disclosure. So all the banks had opportunity to fix it in time. Agenda. First, I will talk about the critical security issues, and by critical, I mean either problems exploitable in the wild or truly epic failures, but I don't want to spoil it right now. Then I will talk about different kinds of issues related to the security also present in the applications I tested. Then I will tell you how hard it is actually to contact security department of an average bank, and then at the end a few words about where our personal data can go, or when, where they can be extracted from some metadata. So the critical security issues. I won't translate the brands, so let's just call this application the green one. If you start this application and choose the contactless payments with your phone, but you don't still have any virtualized card, there is an, of course, the screenshots are in Polish for obvious reasons. There is a suggestion that you can, at the very moment, apply for a virtualized payment card. And when you agree, you see this form, and you can see that it's probably HTML because there are some combo boxes, radio button. It's not standard Android toolkit. And when we start this filling this form and check the log cut, what happens in the background, one entry is interesting. So when we copy this URL to the PC browser, what can we see? Exactly the same content. And yeah, it's a fierce problem because it was a different network, different IP, completely different user agent, and bank should immediately treat it as a security breach, but it didn't. I logged out from the mobile application, refreshed the Firefox, and the form was still there. So it was completely disconnected from the mobile session. And also, a second part of the problem, this application worked on Android 4.0, which allowed third-party application to access all the logcat content, of course, if application had proper permission. But if the user wants to play a game really badly, he will agree on everything. So, for example, our, let's call it, evil Tetris, would be able to extract such URL, send it somewhere to the internet, and this guy could fill our form on my behalf. Okay, the Android 4.0 has like 1% of market share right now, but if you have 1 million customers, like this bank probably has, it's still 10,000 affected users. So yeah, when this URL leaked to the internet, someone took it over, what could happen? Apart from ordering the payment card for me, the attacker could check my name, my birth date, my personal ID number, my personal ID card number, and some other data I wouldn't like to share with everyone on the internet. So this problem is a classic data leak. Another problem can be shown on the demo, of course pre-recorded because the demo never works. But let's check the movie. Okay, I will try to explain what we see here. In the background, there is a Firefox browser. On the right side, we have mirror of the phone screen, and on the left side, there is an application who watches the log cut and waits, as you can guess, for some content to be opened. So it goes like this. At the beginning, we log into the application. As you may guess, this PIN is no longer valid. And yeah, we are now logged in into a bank application, and it's a very old app. It was created using obsolete and abandoned framework, so a bank couldn't really develop it anymore. And what they do. Before they prepared a completely new application, they had they gave to users a chance to work with something nicer by placing this button with kind of flower, which transfers the user to the responsive web application in the Chrome or whatever browser user will choose. So it goes like this. We are selecting Chrome. It opens. Wait for it. Boom, I said. Yeah. This active session present on the mobile is now sitting in the Firefox on a PC. Because I will tell you how it happened, but the point is this: there was some kind of race condition in the bank application, and this single sign-on link was hijacked by this program. But it could be also an evil Tetris. It was transferred to a PC, and the PC won. And the session was taken over. Do you see it? Not yet. And now, yeah. So what was the reason? It's a little surprise, but this bug was actually a result of security protection in another place. If you start Facebook and open JavaScript console, you will see a warning: dear user, do not copy and paste anything here. It's only for developers. It won't make any good for you. And it's the same warning here on a bank login website. It basically says that it's only for developers. Do not paste anything here. And it's, of course, protection before the self-XSS, the sociological attack when you convince user to paste some JavaScript code into your browser, and yeah, for example, you could be convinced that you will be able to read private messages of your wife or anyone, which won't happen. You will just lose your session or have your account hijacked. So this warning should mitigate such risk. But if we click this single sign-on link, which contains a secret which tells the web application that this user should start his session already being logged in, this warning is printed in console. But Android browser doesn't have a console, so it's pushed into the logcat with the URL attached for identification, which tab printed this message. And yeah, at this moment we had single sign-on link in logs, and due to invalid token handling and ignoring changing of user agent and all other characteristics of this connection, this session is now hijacked. And the Google and Microsoft and other big companies would probably pay quite a lot of cash for such security issue. We will get back to this. And one more problem with this SSO link. It's a secret, and secret shouldn't be put into a implicit intent, because other applications can subscribe to using some kind of filter. For example, our evil Tetris could subscribe to this action view of protocol HTTPS and hostname login engbank.pl, and in this and only this case, it would present a user a choice: maybe you should use Chrome for ENG Mobile, like dedicated variant, better one than regular Chrome. And if user will choose this option, the perfect man in the middle will be possible, because this evil application will be able to mimic the web browser and act like one, until, for example, money transfer beacon off is being made, and then change the target account number, and boom. Another problem spotted in another application, masked password leak. This was actually a series of bad practices. Network communication with no pinning, we will get back to this. Masked password characters sent directly, like this one, is a part of password. And you can argue with this one, so I don't want to die for this point, but the third one is something really, really bad. The whole network data which was sent and received was also printed to logcat. And yeah, it's quite easy for malware to check logcat content, and in this case, after few login sessions, the malware or any attacker able to hijack this either communication or logcat content could reconstruct the whole password. The problem with Idea Bank was rather problem with backend architecture than the mobile app, but the test should reveal it anyway. After successful logon, with no certificate pinning as well, the backend sent to the application everything bank knows about customer, including the name, last name, personal ID number, address, phone number, mother's maiden name, ID card number and validity date, and some other internal bank data. And the problem is, apart from the application which uses only the name and last name, that such comprehensive information can be used by attacker to, for example, reset password in all other banks customer uses, because basically the only secret shared between bank and customer is this, for example, validity date, ID card number, mother's maiden name. And if attacker knows that, he can reset the password through the phone everywhere else. Also, you can learn a few things about yourself if you are using this application. For example, I learned that I'm on a level 1, so I guess some more crafting and I will reach level 2. And my customer risk level is elevated. Completely don't know why. Okay, I know. Because it was basically no traffic on this bank account, and one time I called customer support to reset the password late at night, so it was probably the reason. And yeah, I thought that it was bad enough, but the next, you won't believe the next slide, just so I will show you. Double facepalm is not enough. The triple facepalm was required, because when you check the content of the APK file, you will find user's CSV file. And inside, the content looks like usernames and passwords, and there was over 100 of them, and one of the last ones, well, the login name was the company on prod, so you can guess. The thing is, it would be probably illegal for me to try those logins, so I wasn't able to do anything. But one time I was commuting to work, and I was wondering, saying out loud, I wonder if it's possible to log into Idea Bank using credentials from this CSV file. And there was a guy standing next to me with hood over his head. I didn't see his face. And he said, yes. So I said, I wonder if there is any real money on those accounts. And he said, not much. And then he came off. I never saw him again. I don't know who it was, so I don't know if we can trust him, but but you can still find this APK version in the internet, because it never actually gets deleted from the internet if you upload something there. So yeah, that's about it when it comes to critical problems spotted in the applications. There were many other problems. Let's talk about the bug code found in the application. As a rule and good practice, you should never leave the bug code in your application. And this green app we saw at the beginning, for example, allow us, okay, I'm not really sure if we can reach those screens as regular user, but on a rooted phone you can run any activity you want, and we can see some debug content here, probably to be used by software testers. On the right side we see some kind of experiment with OpenSSL, whatever it is. Left there and present in the version uploaded to the store, and we can speculate that those two screens are probably harmless. But in the another application, the Credit Agricole, we can find an activity which allows us to switch server address, just like this. From the HTTPS Credit Agricole PL something controller, we can switch, for example, to request bin, even without safe connection. And then we try to log in, and voila. Application now uses the new custom endpoint. It's a very big problem, because this new string visible here, it will be stored in shared preferences file, a regular XML outside APK. Okay, we are being taught every time that you should not hard code anything in your application, use parameterization file, whatever, but in this particular case, you have to hard code your endpoint, because otherwise you will get into problems. Of course, in theory, the applications are sandboxed and nothing wrong could really happen. But in practice, there was a series of Alcatel devices where stock ROM contained the package called the Qualcomm System Agent, some kind of diagnostic tool provided by the platform manufacturer. And every third-party application could send an intent to this system agent asking, dear system agent, could you please write this content to this file? And voila, it happened, because system agent ran with the super user permissions. So on this Alcatel devices, every application could compromise the Credit Agricole application, routing the whole network traffic through some third-party server. Also, there was this Alcatel wasn't very popular, but there was a problem like 2 years ago with the Samsung Galaxy S devices, because the keyboard—I don't remember the brand—the keyboard was downloading updates through unsecured connection. And if I understood correctly, it was a zip file which was extracted with super user permissions. So going using the directory traversal technique, such crafted update could also change endpoint. Am I right, Nick? Mm-hmm. Okay, so It could probably work by using the directory traversal in the zip. So yeah, it was in theory it shouldn't happen, but in practice leaving such debug option could lead to really serious problems, like we see here. Also, when it comes to third-party libraries, for example, Eurobank contained the Leak Canary library, which is a great tool to detect memory leaks in debug builds. And the manual clearly states that you should never ship the full version in your release builds. And as we see, it was present. The more general remark regarding the third-party code, no one really does a security review of each third-party component. There were applications which included over 20 third-party components. So, you know, it's enough that one of 20 is compromised and the application itself also will be compromised. Some surprises found inside APK files. BankSmart application included very detailed information what are the debug switches which could be used in while compiling the test version of the application. And you know, the internal jokes, for example, about Putin are not really funny anymore when they are exposed on events like this. They become quite embarrassing. In another application, there was some KML files in the resources. Okay, completely harmless, but proving that no one really checked the content of the APK before uploading to the store, because such unused files shouldn't be included in the release version of application. In another app, I found some Jenkins logs, which, for example, revealed the operating system and some paths, which could be useful for attacker if you would like to attack the developers of this application. And for example, the ENG contained some artifacts of Facebook library, also not matching the Android APK file schema and completely useless. Multimedia content was also present. For example, Citibank application had this example of Chinese money transfer template or something like this. Not very useful for customers in Poland. You know, we have Latin alphabets if you're not aware. Problems with code and architectures. That one was really annoying, and yeah, it made me a little bit nervous. Every time when you start application of bank BNP Paribas or Alior Bank, you could spot in logs warning that some things with something are not safe. The operating system warns the developer that something is not right. And the developers and QA specialists had literally thousands of chances to spot it and somehow address it. And I don't want to be rude, but this CEO of this company, Komar, he supposedly said one time that every specialist can be replaced by a finite number of students. And it's a perfect illustration of this approach, because they clearly didn't know what they are doing. What was wrong with this code? The whole network communication was provided by a service, a component of this application, and the service was addressed from the other parts of this code with a text filter. not by some package and class name, but by text filter, which could be hijacked by any other application. And if such application was present, for example, this is a snippet of my service doing nothing, we can see that the breakpoint set in this place showing us that that my application and my service in other app actually was reached by this BNP Paribas app, and this app would never work. There wouldn't be any slightest chance for any customer support to find out what is happening and why this application doesn't work. Not a chance. Possibly, if I don't know if it's possible, but if it would, a third-party service, for example, provided by me, could make an HTTP calls and provide results to this application. And if it could work, it would be also a very, very nice man in the middle. Another problem, this time with screenshots. Only application basically embedded in a ROM image with proper permission and signing key can make screenshots. That's the theory, because in the case of this Alcatel devices I mentioned, every application could ask Qualcomm system agent, would you be so nice and take a photo for me and store it under that path? And Qualcomm system agent, of course, would, and such screenshots could be done. So if the application author won't set a secure flag on the activity used for entering PIN or password, a series of quick screenshots could reveal the whole PIN or password of given user. I tried to include every screenshot here with this digits or letters marked, and we see that most of the applications I tested didn't block such feature. There were also some other flaws. For example, the bad practice of trusting user content. One of the application included a feature when you could take a photo of some loyalty cards, enter their validity date, number, you could name it somehow, and this application could store such entries. And if I entered a name like this, up, etc. password, this application actually tried to load image using this name. So yeah, it's clearly developer's fault, because you shouldn't even trust anything provided by the user and not validated some way. Also, the making a photo didn't work at all, because this card IO library was too old, and on 64 devices it just didn't load. Another problem, arbitrary object deserialization. In this application, everyone could send an intent to start this startup activity, and if there was some content attached under this key, it would get immediately deserialized, casted to some kind of interface, and used in the process. And this application was obfuscated, so there were at least four classes implementing this interface, and the content of this object wasn't validated in any way. Uh, Bank Millennium, the parametrization for this application was kept in XML file inside the directory of this app. We already know that malware can relatively easily modify such files, and one of the nodes in this XML was a number of account of bank account of social security institution. So if you have a company, you have to make money transfer to this account each month, and all of those accounts are ended with five zeros, like this one. But if we modify this digit, of course, also fixing the control code number, this modified number appears here, and it didn't change for last like 20 years. So it's not a big chance that it will instantly change, and it will be good that this parametrization is right in the XML where we can easily modify it. It's actually a source of problem. Also, it was possible to modify, for example, the forgotten PIN link, because if you change this URL to anything else, and you try to use the PIN reminder, it would transfer you to this hijacked URL. Another application, the very same problem, but this time stored in the SQLite database. As in previous case, also also here the integrity of this parametrization file was not enforced anyway. So in any way, so it was possible to modify this account number. It again appeared in the UI. And in case of this application, I was even able to intercept the traffic. So so I tried to make such money transfer, and on the fiddler I intercepted and stopped, of course, the request when this fake account number was present in the outgoing network communication. The bank people later told me that, of course, it would be detected and prevented on the backend side, but it shouldn't be possible to modify such numbers that didn't change at all. Just a remark: I didn't modify the outgoing network traffic in any case, so the bank servers were untouched, and the basically I did everything good. Speaking of network communication, two pieces of good information and one piece of bad information. When it comes to communication with transactional services, the HTTPS or TLS connections were used every time, and the certificates were verified. But the problem is about half of the applications trusted the user trusted certificates, and in some cases it would allow everyone to modify the traffic going up and down, because it was there was no extra protection in the communication layer. In some cases, the requests and responses were signed, and there were also a case or two when additional layer of security was built on top of the HTTPS, which allowed to eavesdrop the communication. There was one interesting case, the Bank Millennium. It did everything good when it comes to certificate pinning. The connection was prevented immediately, But if you waited on this, for example, login screen 15 seconds, you could spot that the information of this crafted certificate was uploaded to the bank. So, of course, in my case, it was a certificate issued by "Do not trust Fiddler Root." So, it didn't really raise an alarm on the bank side. But if it would be any malicious CA issuing certificate for hostname Bank Millennium PL, the bank would be notified immediately, and it would actually allow them to respond in time. Sadly, not every piece of communication was done using the HTTPS. Those two people are owners of my company, the PGS software, and you'd like to use this green application in our company network, it is possible that instead of some advertisement, you would see their pictures here, because the content was loaded through unsecured communication. So it's not a Photoshop, it's actual screenshot, and many applications worked that way. That, for example, some kind of PDF documents were linked through unsecured HTTP, and we all know why it's a problem. If someone in the middle would exchange such document with the PDF content with the big warning, "User, you are not safe, you have to install this security enhancement right now," many users would trust such message, because you know, it was delivered by their bank, so such attack could succeed. And sometimes it was even embarrassing when, for example, you had information in the application "use safely," and this moves you to some web content without the secure connection. So everything could be possible at this point. There were also examples of some nice practices. For example, this app on the screen was able to update app content even without updating the application through the store. Because when you started just after installing the application, it would show the security instructions with the unsecure link, but after I reported this problem to them, it turned out that they were able to update this content even without updating app. So next time the application started, the link was already fixed. If you are including any features based on data downloaded through unsecure content, you will end up with the ATM map looking like this. You know, crafted by me. A few words about the websites and domains and package names. There are screens from the last summer, the middle of 2016. Fortunately, it's not true anymore, but if you tried to open the website of biggest Polish bank using the HTTPS, it would just redirect you to unsecure connection. The same day, second biggest Polish bank, same case, you are typing HTTPS and you are moved to the unsecure version. There were more examples of such situation, like the Raiffeisen Polbank. Currently, it just times out, but sometime before, it was no route to host when you try to access the website through HTTPS. And of course, apart from that, there were some problems with certificates, like if you try to open Polish Citibank website using the HTTPS, you will learn that citibank.pl tries to use a certificate issued for the citibank.com and citigroup.com and city.com, but sadly not the citibank.pl. There was, for example, also the Orange Finance brand, which on the Orange Finance PL is trying to use certificate for the Orange Finance.com. And of course, they also had Orange Finance.com PL, which also didn't work. So you would expect that banks should be able to handle such issues. Shouldn't be that hard. And why it's a problem? Because if you cannot access the bank website in a secure way, how do you know which bank application is the legit one in the Play Store? For example, if you want to try, if you want to install the mBank application, it's possible that at the very moment you will try to install, someone will upload the malicious version, and you won't know which one is valid. Of course, there is some kind of social proof that if some application has 1 million downloads, it's probably the legit one. But it's not something that is always possible. And on a PC, the only thing that will tell you something about this application will be the package name. And there are cases where the pairing is pretty straightforward. For example, mBank PL, package name PL mBank. It could use some branding like the PKO BP PL with some ICO with this brand for this application, but it's still okay. It's no longer okay when the developer of the application puts himself in the front, like this Elidor company or Comarch, pushing the actual bank brand somewhere at the end, like this. And in some cases, you have no chance to guess what is it. For example, in these two cases, the first one, wait for it, is Citibank, in Polish, City Handlowy, because it was a merger. Also, in the second case is the T-Mobile Bank Services. Okay, this one is tricky because it was a part of the Alior brand at the beginning. It was sold and the package name had to stay. Okay, so I told you about many security issues. Basically, the most interesting ones. There were also many repeating all over again, but little more boring. And I wanted to report them to bank responsibly. So the security officers in bank would be the first guys to learn about my findings. So how can you contact security department in bank? You can try on web page. There is nothing. You can try to call customer service. Of course, the customer service is always outsourced, and the people working there, there is always high rotation, low pay. So, and it's outsourced, so it's not a part of the bank, and you shouldn't really trust the customer service giving them any sensitive information. So what I did was asking the customer service whether they could either transfer my call to the real bank people, they weren't able, or if they could ask the security department to call me back. Also not a chance. So the one thing I could do was using the this email and contact forms on the website, and it also didn't work very well. I mean, I sent them message. Basically, you don't need to learn it. It was a question about the procedure, about the declared response time, and more important, about the PGP key I could use to encrypt the message to send later to the general catch-all email. And I sent these questions all at once on some Thursday after 3 p.m., which is end of business day in some institutions. And I was very curious what will happen. And it turns out that two banks were able to answer the same day, sending me their PGP keys. Four other banks were able to do the same thing in next two business days, so Friday or Monday, and the third bank responded with their public PGP key a week later, and as you can easily count, it's not even a half of the banks involved. But I guess there were all the cases where employees actually knew what the PGP is, because in other cases there, yeah, it was a little bit funny. For example, the home crafted secure data transfer mechanism suggested by one of banks, so I could send them a password protected zip file and send password to some provided phone number, and it would make a secure communication with the bank possible, but not really. In many cases, I just got no response, or the response that our best people are working on your request, the one about the PGP. So the ping pong, the reminder and empty answer or no answer was taking weeks, and I was getting close to my internal deadline of 1 month before disclosure, so I had to address it somehow. So for example, I browsed the LinkedIn whether any of the bank board members are publishing their email, because if they do, they like receiving emails. So in such case, I wrote them that I'm trying to contact security department in your bank for a week now, and it doesn't work, and I have the important security information. What could you do about it? And you can imagine this brown mother going from up down to bottom of the bank structure, and they called me back in like 1 hour. So it works. When you are contacting the PR people, it also works, but it takes a little longer, like 3 days or so. But at the end, I was able to contact all the banks. In one case, it was 3 weeks instead of 4 I wanted. But all the banks received my and confirmed my information, and not to blame anyone, but the difference was clear: which banks had any procedures and which ones improvised everything. Yeah, since the very beginning, I was wondering what will happen with the bug bounties or any rewards or anything, because you know the Google or Facebook or Microsoft are paying really good money for responsible disclosing the security issues to them, and of course the Hall of Fame was out of the question, because no bank honors people who are able to break the protections. But I was wondering whether I receive any, I don't know, t-shirt or maybe money, and it turned out that there was one case when a bank issued, you know, it's nothing very pricey, but it was a nice gesture to receive a written thank you note along with some small gift, and that's it. I mean, before the conference, I talked about it for the first time. There was nothing more. But at the conference, the guys from the ING Bank approached me and asked whether I got any bug bounty from them, because the international website of the ING states that they are rewarding the responsible disclosure, and I said none of such thing happened, and they were surprised, and they told me that they will check what they can do. And a few weeks later, I actually received money in their bug bounty program. Yeah, you remember, it was this bank where the remote session takeover was possible. So I received 125 euro for my report. Yeah, because from the bugs I listed, they recognized three issues worth 25 euro each, and one issue worth 50 euro. So, and yeah. So also the bug bounty is clearly possible in the banks area, and that shouldn't stop you from trying, you know. The last topic for today, I will just make a quick notes about it. The case of Crashlytics. Who of you is using the Crashlytics service? Yeah, a bunch of people. It's a very nice service which gathers the remote crash logs. Draw a nice chart and aggregate this report, so you can easily check what is your crash rate in the end user devices. It was recently bought by Google from Twitter, and the problem for European users is that this service is hosted in USA, and apart from the 12 people, the US citizens here, we are all enemies of the US, you know. And the CIA is looking after us, and we shouldn't feed them with any information, so that they get this for free. And in case of a few banks, it basically happens, because if the application crashes on the end user device, previously, okay, Google already know it, but previously Twitter was notified that this user has this application. And in theory, only the stack trace and some metadata is uploaded, but for example, if the application crashes in an activity called, I don't know, the mortgage approved success last step .java, it would clearly state that this user applied for loan and it was granted. So the metadata will pass such information. And two of those applications are asking whether you want to upload the crash log, but it doesn't still says that it will be sent to the USA. And as a rule, the European financial institutions cannot share any information with the US companies. So the similar problems was present in now discontinued old version of the ING app, which had a Facebook library integrated. So each time application started, the ping "I'm alive" information was sent to the back Facebook servers, And there was no information in terms and conditions, no opt-out mechanism, no nothing. It just happened. And of course, Facebook was perfectly able to cross-match this information with their user base and store such information forever, because as European people, our rights are and personal data are not protected at all in US, so they can match it and store it. And I'm not an enemy of the analytic or remote crash reporting, but such data should be transferred directly to the banks, not any third-party services, especially outside our countries or outside the European Union. I don't know too much about the law in this area, so it would be great if someone competent could address such issues, and I would love to learn about it. But what I can do is only a signal that there is something not right here. If you want to know more about my research, you can download the white paper, which is written in much better English than mine. So I wrote it in Polish, and it was translated by someone who actually know how to use English. I guess it will be also uploaded to the conference website. So yeah, so it also will be possible to find it there. And yeah, as a summary, my research proved that there were much more security issues that I would expect. Most of them could be prevented by some more detailed QA check. It's very hard to report actual security vulnerability to average bank, and we should remember about our data and actively try to prevent leaking them to another countries. And that's it. Thank you for having me. Do you have any questions?
Thank you very much, Thomas. I'm afraid that we are really out of time. So if someone has questions, I guess you will be here.
Yes, I will
so
be here, and also
to take the questions offline.
I will also, I will be here tomorrow, so we can talk
Perfect.
Anywhere you like.
Perfect. Thank you very much. See you tomorrow.